Our service begins on page 2. Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Sing together the Gloria.
And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, Make ready quickly three measures of choice flour needed in a case. Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant, who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and calf that he prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where's your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There, in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening to the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It has ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed at herself, saying, "After I have grown old, and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old?' Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. He said, "Oh yes, you did laugh." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm today is Psalm 116, also on page 3, which we will read responsibly in full verse. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication, because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I call upon him. I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants.
O Lord, I am your servant, and I am your servant, the child of your name. You have freed me from my bonds.
I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. Lord's house in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. Hallelujah.
James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Demonian, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out the demons. You receive without payment, give without payment. This is the gospel of the Lord.
That I never used a pronoun for God.
She asked if this was intentional, and she went on to say that by not using a pronoun for God, I forced her to try to imagine the way God is, not the way God looks. The way God is, not the way God looks. I breathed a sigh of relief, and I complimented the woman for her keen observation and astute insight. I responded that my avoidance of pronouns, not always, but quite frequently on my part, when speaking about God, was in fact intentional. I explained that given the limitations of our infinite language in trying to speak of God, who is infinite, that not only are we better served, but perhaps God is also better served when we avoid pronouns, or even nouns when speaking about God. And the question came up as to why? And my answer is because we should try to speak about God the way in which God speaks to each of us. And so, this begs the question, how is it that God speaks to us? The God in which I have faith does not speak to us as a static being. Rather, God speaks to us as a dynamic, restless force in this world. This, for me, is what God's revelation in Jesus is all about. Reflecting on another gospel, the Gospel of John tells us that in the beginning was the world, was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Word was God, and the Word became flesh. Inasmuch as Jesus is the incarnate Word of God speaking to us, then for us to speak about God the way in which God speaks is for us to speak that very Word that became flesh. What then does this mean? How are we to speak about God? I believe we are to speak about God by first and foremost acting in ways that are worthy. Being worthy starts with recognizing that each and every one of us is a child of God, regardless of whatever or whoever else claims us. We are claimed first by God. We belong to God. We are God's. That fact alone is what gives us worth, sacred worth. It is what makes us worthy. And so we are to act as the worthy people that we are. Fundamentally, doing so is recognizing the sacred worth of all others. It cannot be said enough. There is no human being that is not worthy, worthy of being treated with divine dignity, even as they are worthy of acting with divine dignity. Put simply, no matter how it may seem at times, what we expect from ourselves, we should expect from one another. And what we expect from each other, we should expect from ourselves. It is an expectation of worthiness. It is in being worthy that we speak of God. And it is in being opportunistic. We must seize every opportunity in time to act in ways that makes God's loving presence real in the time that is ours. Time is precious. It is precious, I believe, not because it is fleeting, but because it is filled with the possibilities of making real that which is most precious to us. That is the love that is God. I think of time as being filled with the possibilities of God's love. So at times and in each time, we have the opportunity to speak of that love that is God, which means at all times and in each time, we are to be nothing less than loving. To speak about God means for us to be receptive. Receptive to God's forgiveness and his forgiving grace. To be human is to mess up, which I do quite frequently. To make mistakes, which I do more than quite frequently. And to sin, which I do, but I try not to. But I have to be honest and say, yes, I'm a sinner. No matter how great we think we are, sin is an unavoidable reality of our human existence. Yet, as unavoidable as sin is, we do not have to be defined by it. For there is no sin committed that is not a sin forgiven, forgiven by the forgiving grace of God. This is a grace that frees us. It frees us to grow into our better selves. It frees us to grow and believe in ourselves in the way in which God believes in each of us. That is, to believe that we are good and that we can be who God has called us to be. Through forgiveness, God frees us to become better people. And it is through forgiveness that we can help one another become better people. It is through forgiveness, not condemnation, that we grow into our best selves. And so, we are to be receptive to God's forgiving grace as it applies to ourselves and to others. In doing so, we speak about God. And finally, if we are to speak about God, we must be daring. We must dare to live collectively, that is, as if God's promised future is already here. The manner in which we conduct our living should be a foretaste of God's coming. This means that we must live as if every single human being, regardless of their language, their color, their country of origin, their income, their education, deserves food, clothing, shelter, care, because they do. We are to live as if the bigotry, fear, stereotypes, hateful isms that separate us from one another are no more. We are to live as if compassion, not condemnation, justice, not judgment, and righteousness, not self-righteousness, are the watchwords of humanity. We are to live as if the peace of God, that is justice, has come to earth. Even if these ways of acting are not the ways of our world at this time, we must be daring enough to make them a way of our living. To speak about God is then more than a matter of using words. It is a matter of embodying the very word that was God. We do this when we are least worthy, opportunistic, receptive, daring forces in the world, as was the word of God, and Son and confess as the coming flesh. Now, why am I talking about this today? Because it was as I thought about a talk given by a presiding bishop, Michael Curry, and that conversation I had this week with a woman after the healing service came back to me, caused me to change things. Why? How do we speak to God? And I realized that as eloquent a speaker as Bishop Curry is, the most powerful words he spoke about God were not those that came through the way in which he was a force, a movement for God's loving justice in our world. He was clear that it is his Christian faith that propelled him into the Jesus movement and calling us to be crazy Christians. And I believe that I am one of those crazy Christians. For him, his commitment to the struggle was nothing less than his testimony of faith. That is, his way of speaking about God. As much God talk as there is in the world today, not many people are really speaking about their God or gods for that matter. For if they were, I have little doubt that our world would be a much different place, perhaps more reflective of the beloved community about which Bishop Kirby speaks of. A world more reflective of the God that is always more than a pronoun. Yes, I said to the woman after the healing service, I am purposeful and not using pronouns when I speak about God. And she looked at me like she wanted to know why. Because I try my best to use words that reflect the word of God to us. Words that inspire and empower us to speak about God in a worthy, opportunistic, receptive, and daring way in which God speaks to each of us. These are the words that I've been thinking about on this day and am sharing with each of you. And to that I say, thanks be to God.
Of all that is seen and unseen, we believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, through
one being the Father,
through whom all things were made.
For us and for our salvation,
he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and was saved by him. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers for the people are found on page 5. On this day, remember fathers. Let us offer our prayers to God, who has adopted us as sons and daughters through the waters of baptism. O God, you formed your son Adam from the dust of the ground and breathed your holy breath into his lungs, giving us all the gift of life. Breathe it in your life into us, your children, and your church, that we might be one with you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord of all, you formed great nations out of great families, and bless the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that they might be a blessing to all. Bless our nation and all the nations of the world with your fatherly presence, wisdom, and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As the children of Israel found themselves slaves, making bricks for Pharaoh before you heard their cry and brought them to freedom, we pray for all in this world who are in trouble of any kind.
We pray for the poor, the hungry, the imprisoned, the victims of war, and all who live in terror's way. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Your Son Jesus neither married nor raised children of his own, but he helped countless people come and return to the fullness of life and to life everlasting. And so we pray for all who nurture others with love and patience as spiritual parents. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Jacob's son Joseph, to whom he gave the radiant coat, was beaten, betrayed, and sold into a life of hardship before rising to greatness. And so we pray for all who are injured, hurt, sick, lonely, or live in fear, especially Harriet Duff, Betty Bradshaw, Claudia, Matthew, Joseph, Mildred, Reese Kelly, Charlie, Barbara, Priscilla Chatfield, Michael, Rosie, Harlan, Alexa, Pierce, Jean Bancroft, Jean Daw, Barbara Casey, Patricia, John B., Catherine C., Sean Sullivan, Jackie, Lee, Catherine, and any we nominate silently or loud. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, as our Heavenly Father, you gave us the gift of your own Son, and out of our human blindness, the crowds called for him to die on the cross. We pray for the dying and the dead, especially. Bring all your children home. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Say together, our Father,
who dwells in heaven,
we pray for all fathers,
saints, and blessed fathers to be faithful, loving, and present, and for those fathers who have brought us into the kingdom, ahead of their children, and children ahead of their fathers, enfold them with your holy light, and enfold us with your comfort. Now and forever, Abba, we pray. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with Father and Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Welcome everyone, especially
series of forums, not July 4th weekend, but at 9 a.m. in the library. We're going to talk about four of our different outreach ministries on the four Sundays following July 4th weekend, because there's five Sundays in July. Diane's going to start us off talking about Hunger Ministries in Bridgeport. So if you're interested in learning more about the Sundays, they're listed in your leaflet, the July forums. We'll have Homefront with Sean O'Brien, and Catherine's been very involved with Homefront. Jerusalem Peace Builders on July 23rd. We'll know who's coming on that soon. Susie Whitcomb will talk about HEI, Patient Educational Initiative. So part of your pledge to Trinity goes to outreach, and it's just truly meaningful what we do as a parish for those in need, not just our neighbors here in town and in Bridgeport, but also abroad. So please join us if you're able. There is coffee today and refreshments in the parish. Also, join us for some fellowship right after the service. And next week, we'll conclude our forum at 9 a.m. about The Four Loves by C.S. Lewis, the last time of the game Charity, so that will be our topic next Sunday at 9. Now, we have a mission trip happening, and we've got about 12 of your fellow parishioners going on this trip. Raise your hand if you're going. I see Jeff over there, and the True Loves are going. Two folks from 8 o'clock. Beth Bode has been organizing us. If you'd like to participate in the mission trip by helping out with a wish list, we don't actually need the actual tools, but we're going to give a check to the reservation, the Roosevelt reservation, to be able to purchase some of these much needed tools from food housing and community buildings. So if you'd like to participate in that way, there's instructions here. And a few other announcements. Anybody else have an announcement? I wonder if there's any children here. Are they back? Okay, not here. I have a little children's time. Maybe we'll see that later. But you notice we have on the cover of our bulletin a beautiful winged bird. I think it's an egret. We have a couple living right behind the church in the marsh. And I wanted to point that out to the kids. We're going to try to have different small-legged birds. Our former warden was the executive director of the Connecticut Audubon Society, so he thought that was great. Walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God. And our offertory hymn today, the awesome story. Thank you.
is right to give our thanks and praise.
All thanks and praise are yours at all times and in all places, our true and loving God, through Jesus Christ, your eternal Word. The wisdom from on high, by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to human kind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so, as the morning star sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings in all creation as we shout with joy.
Forever and ever. Amen.
these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and rose again, and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage, the love and serving, the gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make the journey with us. So be swift to love, and make haste to be kind. And the blessing of God, who made us, who loves us, and who travels with us, be with you now and